Hello, good morning together. My name is Benno Stein, as last week, and I say hello to you this morning in the name of all of us, and welcome to the second reading, the third for you in Leipzig, the second in Weimar. I only want to explain what the second part, ML2, is covering. We bring you, show you the mathematical roots of machine learning, which is regression. You should understand this, since nearly all procedures and methods that we will learn are based on regression. We do not go too deeply, but we show you the essence. It is more or less a recap of your mathematical backgrounds. With concept learning, we introduce you that machine learning at heart means search in the hypothesis space. Machine learning means which of my explanations is best suited. And with machine learning, we develop methods to search efficiently and effectively in the hypothesis space. The second part of concept learning, search in the version space, is all about bias. Machine learning always introduces bias on purpose. It means it explains complicated things by simple means. And how this happened and why this happened is explaining concept learning. And finally, evaluating effectiveness lays the ground for you to understand how to measure the quality, the performance of a machine learning algorithm. We will introduce these four things seriously, but we cannot go too deep in each of them. Perhaps you have learned about explainability. Explainable AI is today a keyword, a buzzword that is said in many places. Each time I hear this, explainable AI, I'm thinking there is not much to be explained if you understand what's happening. Explainable AI means what is happening during regression, in which way the search is done, how big is the bias, and how do I measure performance. It means what you learn today and next week is how to explain your machine learning results, your solutions. This is at heart explainable AI. I guess we hand over to Martin, who's now giving a short introduction and recap of some elements of regression, shows the connection to learning. After him, I will start an introduction into search and hypothesis space with a certain learning problem, a certain example, and we won't go very deep into all slides. Some things which are important for us and for you will be treated more detailedly. Others, we are thinking that you have read them already or that you will recap them after this reading. That's all of my side, and I'm looking forward for Martin introducing regression.
Thank you, Benno. So, start right away with a small recap from last week. You remember we saw a problem about judging whether a customer of a bank is creditworthy, whether the bank should give him credit or no. And you saw that what the bank knows about the customer. So they know a couple of different things, whether they are house owners, what income they have, what repayment per month, the credit they want to have is, what's the period of credit, and so on and so forth. They know a total of P different things about the customer. Whatever they want to ask and can legally ask, they can ask, and those are the P different things they know. And this is basically what we then call the feature space the bank has created for customers, because they do not know the customer as a whole, they only know what they have recorded. These P different features. And the decision the bank needs to make is whether or not to give the customer credit. And we encode this as a set of two classes. And we can call the class yes or no, we can call it 0, 1, but a very common way of saying it is -1 and 1. It's a bit mathematical, and you will see in a couple of minutes why this makes sense. And the bank has a number of customers to which it already has extended credit. And we collect all these customers in our database. And these are our examples. So we have here customer one and his representation in feature space as p-dimensional vector and the decision that has already been made. And all the way through customer n, and the decision has been made for this customer. So it's a Cartesian product of the feature space X and the classes, the set of classes. And we call this D our ground truth. So the classifier C is the mapping of customers to classes. And this is our ground truth for the creditworthiness class. Suppose, so this is one problem we call classification, and this is what we very often want to solve in machine learning. There's another problem that you might look at, and it's called regression. Here's in contrast, the regression problem, and here maybe assume that the bank has already given the customer credit and now decides how much credit to extend to the customer. So how much dispo credit you get on your debit card, for example. And this is a real value decision. So we have a subset of the real numbers and the credit value could be 500 euros, could be 1000 euros, could be 10,000 euros, dependent on how creditworthy the customer is in total. So this is called the credit line. And in regression, we set up a very similar problem. We have our customer representation again, the p-dimensional vector about the customer and the credit line that is extended to the customer. This is what we call then here Y1. And this is our ground truth again, and we want to learn in regression how much credit line we should extend to a customer. Okay, so this is what we call a regression problem, and this is what we will look at for now, and later you will see how the two problems can be related. So the basic solution to this problem could be a linear regression model. And it is this is something you also have also already seen in the last lecture. We have a model function, and this is a linear function in the number of parameters the model has, like the weights and the features each individual representation of a customer has. We have p different features, and we have this basic parameter W0, which completes the linear function. We can also rewrite this function in its current form in the sum notation into a vector notation if we say that we have a vector of weights, these W's here, and we multiply the transpose of this vector with the feature vector of the customers. And remember, we have now for each customer a credit line value y1, and this can vary from zero to an infinite amount of number, at least how much the bank would give. So let's say 100,000 euros or something. And what we want now is to learn this model function in a way, or the weights of this model function in a way, so that the results for any given input X do not deviate too much from the value that we already know the example customers we have been extended. So we compute the difference the model predicts for a given set of weights, and in the loss function here, the error function that we built is called the residual sum of squares. This is the difference here is called the residual. And we take the square of this number and sum over all the examples that we have in order to get an idea of how good the model function performs as a whole, given all the n different examples that we have. And you will see now that the only difference we can make is we cannot change the examples we have because they are fixed. The only thing that we can change in this model function are the weights, the weight vector or the individual weights given to each individual variable. So what is income worth? Is this more worth in the decision making than perhaps the credit period or the Schufa entry or the age? And our goal now is to select a weight vector, the weights from the space of all possible weight vectors R to the P plus one that minimizes this error function, RSSW. We call this basically our hypothesis space, and any vector from this hypothesis is called our hypothesis, and we want to find the best hypothesis that minimizes our error. So if we look at an example in one-dimensional feature space, so we have only one dimension x, t equals one, and you could suppose it's the age, for example, age 0 and age 100. And we see now our n examples here, which are distributed across the space. And you see that somehow with increasing age, the credit line value, which is the y-axis here, increases too. And what we could do now is we could draw a function into this space that we would say would fit very well the data, maybe. The model function that we have is a line. It defines a line in one-dimensional space because we have only one dimension here. And the line might look like this. So you see here now that regardless which line we choose, we cannot find a straight line that goes through all the points. Every point deviates a little bit from the line. And this deviation from the line is what we call the residual. So it is basically this difference here. And we compute now all the residuals for each point, so all the deviations from the line that we predict, square them and sum them. And this is our residual sum of squares. This is our error function, and this is to be minimized. We want to minimize the sum of all the squares of these deviations. Okay, so since we are in one-dimensional space, the line has two parameters. It has the y-intercept w0 and it has a slope w1. And we can substitute in the function this our expected model function for one dimension. So the function looks like this now. And since we want to minimize the error this function makes given these two parameters, we can apply a direct method. So we can calculate, and this is what's on the next slide, the partial derivation with regards to the first parameter, W0, and then solve this function. So find the zeros of this derivation in order to find the extreme points of this function. And then if we solve this derivation for W0, which we do not show here, but which is basic calculus, we get a function for W0 which tells us how to calculate the best possible value for W0 in the extreme. And this function is rather easy. It is the average of the y values minus W1 times the average of the x values. Second, we have to solve the partial derivation of the RSS function for W1 and find its zeros too in order to find when the function gets extreme for the W1 parameter. And this result here also solving for W1, we get this fraction. And here you see there's no dependency on any other parameter of the function. So what we can do is now, so this value W1 can be directly computed based on the examples we have. So this will be the optimal estimate for this value. And we can substitute W1 in this function and place it here in order to find what is our W0. So this pair of W hat 0 and W hat 1 will give us an extreme point of the RSS function. In order to find out whether the extreme point is actually a minimum or maximum of this function, we would have to then compute the second partial the second partial derivations with regards to all combinations of W0 and W1. This is not shown here, but this would need to be done in order to actually check whether we have a minimum or maximum. Let's assume it's a minimum. So with these two parameters, we have minimized, we have found the two parameters that minimize the function with regards to these example variables. All of this can be done in more dimensions too, so in higher dimensional space. This is we will show you now how to do this in higher dimensional space. So this is the original function. The error function are the residual sum of squares as a difference of the residual squared and summed over all examples in our database. We can rewrite this function in matrix notation. This looks like this. Where we first a step back, we define the matrix X to be an n by p plus one matrix, where every row of the matrix corresponds to one of our input vectors, the example vectors. I can show you those. So it is basically this vector here, or basically everything we know about the customer. Sorry, let's call it back. There we are. So we have every row of this matrix is an input vector plus the one padding for the W0 parameter. And every column corresponds basically to every dimension that we know about our customers. We also can define a vector Y, which is basically all the outputs that we expect for our examples. It is our ground truth vector. And this way, with these two matrices, or with this matrix at this vector, we can replace the sum inside this bracket here and get this sum. It's equivalent to what's written here. It is computing all the residuals at the same time. What's missing still is how to compute the square and the sum. And this is simply done by multiplying this bracket again with the same bracket in transpose form. This squares every scalar that is the result of this difference, and then sums it up as expected. And what we get is basically the exact same output as this formula gives us. It is a quadratic function in p plus one parameters. So if we want to again minimize this function in p plus one dimensional space, we have to do in the direct method the same thing. We have to compute the derivative, the partial derivative of this function with respect to every parameter, which in matrix notation can be written down rather concisely. So we have DRSS by DW, which equals minus 2x transpose times y minus xw. And we have to find the zeros of this function again. So getting from this form to the derivation of this form is again basic calculus. You can try this at home at your leisure. It takes a little while to figure out, but it's not difficult. So in order to find the zeros, we solve the function for W, our parameters that we want to find, that we want to optimize. And you can see solving this function here, or how the solution, you can see the solution here, the derivation of the solution here. And it is basically this matrix times the Y vector. And there's one speciality here. So this, the first step here is basically just normal equation handling, but this step here is a bit special because we have to find the inverse of this square matrix. So the transpose of X, which is not a square matrix, times X gives us a square matrix, and square matrices can sometimes be inverted. Many square matrices can be inverted, but it's not necessarily the case that we have to have a matrix that is invertible. So this is why there's no equivalence relation here. And one precondition is, for example, that the matrix has to have the actual rank p plus one, that is the rank of the same dimensionality that the matrix itself is. So that means the matrix cannot have any column or any row that is linearly dependent on any other column or row. So a column or row that could be removed and or just reformulated by adding a scalar to another column or row. And perhaps as an interesting additional information, if that is the case and the matrix is invertible, we get this matrix here, and in total, this is the pseudo inverse of X. So as I said, not all matrices can be inverted, only square ones can be directly inverted and only under certain conditions. And rectangular matrix like our original matrix X cannot be inverted. However, there are is a generalized form of inversion, and this matrix happens to be one of those, the Moore-Penrose inversion. And it fulfills a number of properties, and you can read up on this on the Wikipedia article that is linked here. So we have now this solution of the first derivation, which gives us the extreme point of the RSS function in vector notation. And we can now use this in order to solve our original problem. We can compute for any given new example xy the prediction of the prediction that our model function would make given these weights, given these optimal weights w hat. Or we can compute right away for all our examples, or for a given matrix of new examples in the form of X, all predictions it would make. So these two methods, in one-dimensional space for ease, or in generalized form for p plus one-dimensional space, gives us the optimal solution for this problem, for the regression problem, regarding all the examples that we know of. So we now have the possibility to find the optimal line that minimizes the deviations of the points from the line in our ground truth data set. So how does this relate to classification? So going back to the beginning, you saw the classification problem is a situation where we want to make a binary, for example, a binary classification, where we want to just say yes or no. Does the customer get credit or doesn't he or she? So what we can do here is we can just replace these real valued credit line scores with our -1, +1 scores in the examples. Those are also real valued. And this means we can apply basically the same regression as before in order to find a function, a line that goes through these points. And it looks like this. So, however, we have not yet really solved the classification problem, because as you can see, we get not necessarily a -1 for any given point. Sometimes it gets close, but oftentimes it will not get close to what we want to know. It is some value bigger or larger than 0 or smaller than 0. What we can do, however, is we can, since we have set up the problem in a way so that we get positive and negative numbers, we can just define a certain boundary at which point the decision switches from no to yes. And this conveniently could be the sign of the y function. So what we could do is we compute for our fitted weights times a given example, the output of the model function, and then just look at the sign of the output. Is it a positive number that comes out, or is it a negative number that comes out? We still have solved the regression problem, but with looking at the sign, we immediately have solved the classification problem as well. We have made, we have turned the example into positive examples and negative examples, and this is very often what you read in papers. We have positive class or negative class, and sometimes in figures you see also pluses and minuses, and this is basically what is meant by this. most of the time. And our decision boundary is basically the y value of zero, and this for y value of zero, for every model function, there is an x prime which makes y zero, and all x values to the left will get a decision of no, negative, and all x values to the right will get a decision of yes or positive. All of this can also be done, since this is the one-dimensional example again, in higher dimensions. So in a higher dimension, for example, in two-dimensional space, we do not get a dot. So perhaps before I go to the higher dimension first, how do we call this? This is our discrimination point. So it's basically a projection of this two-dimensional space of features and model function output onto the feature space only. And since it's one dimension, we have just the line x here, and this dot basically on the line, this point on the line, discriminates between the positive and the negative examples. In two-dimensional space, what we will get and what we will see now is what we get is a line. So now consider two-dimensional space. We have two features, x1 and x2, age and income, for example, and we have again a number of examples for which we know the class they belong to. The positive ones are creditworthy, the negative ones are not creditworthy. And what regression gives us then is basically not a line through this, but a plane. And I can show it right away. Here's the plane. So the plane is described by these three parameters, and it basically also fits in the best way using these parameters the examples that we have. Just like before, when we compute the model function value using the parameters that we have fitted using regression, using a given example, we just look at the sign. Regression gives us any point on this plane, whereas classification just gives us a decision. Is an example positive or negative? And again, looking at the values of the two-dimensional feature space where the model output gets zero, we get a line through this plane. And this is what we call basically our discrimination line. Again, projected now onto the feature space only. So this is what you might have often seen in a book, in a paper. What people say that classification in with machine learning does. We have a number of pluses, we have a number of minuses, or different kinds of objects that we want to separate, and people draw a line between them and say, this is what we do with our machine learning model. But what in fact they do is this. This is to keep in mind, they somehow apply some form of regression or more complex situation there. They learn such a function here, such a linear model function, and then just project this onto the feature space, finding a discrimination hyperplane in p-dimensional space where p is bigger, is free or bigger than free. So this is more or less concluding the basics of regression, and perhaps as a small addition, what you can do, you do not need to just count the original values as is. So you can analyze them and analyze each value individually and see what behavior they have, and you can apply transformation functions on these features, which are listed here for some examples. You can compute the logarithm of a certain variable. You can compute the square root of a variable. You can take the power of a variable. You can set different variables in relation to each other. All of these things can be done to the input variables. This does not change the fact that the learned model in linear regression is a linear function. The model function stays linear in terms of the parameters it has. And the fact that these parameters are summed, all these transformations here are just a function applied to the input variables. And they turn what we call input variables in regression basically into what is then called features. And they basically create an embedding of the raw input variables into a feature space. Perhaps as a last remark, there's the this won't be proved here, and it's not proven in the slides, but the approach that is taken here in regression is the best possible approach under certain circumstances. When we consider the RSS function here, so minimizing the RSS function, minimizing these squared errors of residuals, means or put another way, why use the RSS function? We could define different kinds of error functions. And yes, you could. You could say, we take the cube, or we do not square the errors and just take the absolute value of the error. All of this is possible. However, it has been shown by Gauss and by Markov in succession that using the RSS function is the best possible function to minimize in order to arrive at the in order to find the best possible weights, given that the alternative loss function that you have in mind is also an unbiased estimator, meaning that it is not distorted somehow by bad input data. The examples I've shown you before, they've all been very well behaved in a certain sense. So for example, if we go to this example again, this is very well behaved somehow on this feature space. Somehow the points which are positive align here and the points which are negative align here. And there's a clear boundary between them which can be seen. However, this is not necessarily the case in the real world. There can be a lot of mix up here, and it may very well be that we do not have the exact same amount of examples which are positive and negative, and all of this may affect how the line comes out that we fit. It may look completely different, and it may be much, much worse in terms of actually making a good decision. So this the linear regression does not solve all problems, but when the problem admits of being solved by linear regression, then using the approaches just shown will give us the best possible solution. And the LMS algorithm that you saw in the last lecture is basically the iterative way of finding that solution. Above you saw the direct method by applying calculus, and here the LMS algorithm is the iterative way of finding that solution. I think I will stop now, Benno, and we can hand over.
Very good. No, Martin, very good. I could very well follow, and I was also happy that you demonstrated that what people see in the input space, this green line, this separating line, this is actually the result, the projection from a regression function. Of course, we use not only this simple shape that you have shown here. We have also S-shaped things or a rich regression, but at heart it works all this way. And this is nice that we have illustrated this here. I think it is very important for the students to understand these mathematical roots, because if they take later on advanced material, not in this course but in other courses, the connection to algebra is quite often made, and Martin has shown the roots why this is the case.